Let's find out what stories our North America Bureau is pursuing right now from our correspondent, Henny Espinosa.
Hey guys, here are news-making headlines for Filipinos in North America.
We begin with a proposal to establish a Filipino town in Las Vegas that's been gaining momentum as the city's vibrant Filipino community, now over 200,000 strong, continues to grow. Advocates envisioned a district in Maryland Parkway as a cultural hub, celebrating Filipino heritage while supporting small businesses, events, and services tailored to the largest Asian American and Pacific Islander group in Las Vegas.
It's wonderful that we are being allowed to even look for a designation. And that's one of the first things that I thought about, is a designation for the Filipinos. And we chose Flamingo to Desert Inn. It's short enough and long enough to start because it can always be lengthened. And so with a designation, once we get that, then we can work into the, you know, into the town itself. But just to get a designation takes a long time.
Filipino restaurant owner Paul Tejada believes a Filipino town in Las Vegas is long overdue.
It's about time. I mean, it's only right that they call this area, especially Maryland Parkway, Filipino town. Filipinos has been in this area for 3 decades now, as far as restaurants, businesses, nurses, school teachers coming in this community and making it what it is now.
If approved, Filipino town could break ground as early as next year. In sports, state champion, California Sophomore of the Year, and with long-range shooting skills, Sofia Dignadise is one of the most exciting high school girl basketball prospects.
This year, it's been such a successful year for me because I became more confident in myself, and confidence just comes with the love from the sport you do. You know, you get confidence from knowing that you put all this work in.
Last year, Dignadise averaged 11 points a game as a sophomore for Bishop Montgomery, one of the top high school basketball programs in California. College scouts have been keeping an eye on the guard, who's displayed her three-point shooting skills. Championships and talent run in the family. She's the youngest daughter of 9-time Philippine Basketball Association champion, 3-time All-Star, and FIBA Asia champion Yves Dignadise, a big man who spent most of his epic career playing for San Miguel Beer.
Having the Dignadise name, like, it's such an honor because of how great of a player he was in the PBA. And it's like I can carry that legacy even if it's here, even if it's in the Philippines, like anywhere, I can still carry that name because it's always on my back.
And finally, based out of Portland, Oregon, Talilo Marfil is on the rise, making waves in the hip-hop scene. His body covered in tribal Filipino tattoos. And with his proud Visayan roots, he hopes his music can also spread messages on the Filipino identity.
A lot of my music is really focused on decolonizing, making it sound good too, so that people can digest the message and uplift our people and our culture.
It's evident that we gon' ride that wave.
This year, he released a music video with legendary Philippine tattoo artist Apoang Od. And through this song and music video, he's found an advocacy for the people in Kalinga.
I met up with the elders and learned about their struggles in the village, what they need help with. They need help with the ambulance. They need help with a new irrigation system, which is causing the hillside to deteriorate. And the locals and those that are Kababayan that go up there to get tattoos, people that travel all over the world to get tattoos, they need to learn how to respect them more.
Now, several of Donald Trump's cabinet and administration picks targeted with threats in recent hours. A spokesperson for the president-elect says the threats were made Tuesday night and Wednesday morning, ranging from bomb threats to swatting. Among those threatened, Elise Stefanik, Trump's pick for U.S. ambassador to the U.N., and Lee Zeldin, the choice to head the Environmental Protection Agency. The FBI says it is aware of the threats targeting the incoming administration's nominees and appointees and is working with its law enforcement partners. Israelis protest in Jerusalem to call for a ceasefire in Gaza in the wake of the deal to end the fighting with Hezbollah. About 1,000 attended Wednesday's gathering organized by the women's protest for the return of the hostages. Some 101 Israeli hostages remain captive in Gaza. Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu has vowed both to bring them all home and to eradicate Hamas. Negotiations between the two sides have long stalled, with each side blaming the other for the impasse.
We're now demonstrating because we've seen that a ceasefire is possible. There was a ceasefire in the north. It's time for a ceasefire in the south. 101 hostages are waiting for 418 days for Netanyahu to make the right decision. Ceasefire now and bring them home now.
Hopefully we will hear good news and make some kind of a difference, because can't every day is horrible health for them and for their families. We can't compare it. But we're all in this horrible hell of no values and of them being in a horrible condition and not being able to help them.
As the ceasefire between Israel and Hezbollah holds, people in both countries begin returning to homes in the border area, pounded by 14 months of fighting. Cars and vans piled with belongings streamed through the Lebanese port city of Tyre, heading south, carrying some of the roughly 1.4 million people uprooted by the conflict. They navigated streets littered with rubble from destroyed homes, including their own. The World Bank estimates at least 100,000 housing units across Lebanon have been damaged or destroyed in the hostilities. United Nations Secretary General Antonio Guterres hailing the Lebanon ceasefire, which took effect Wednesday. Guterres says this is the first ray of hope in the regional conflict after months of escalation. This as he reiterates his call for an immediate ceasefire in Gaza.
It is essential that those who signed the ceasefire agreement fully respect it. And it is essential that this commitment paves the way for a political solution to the Lebanese crisis. And at the same time, I can assure you that UNIFIL, the United Nations peacekeeping force, which has been in Lebanon, is currently prepared to make its contribution to verifying this ceasefire with full commitment.
Philippine police file a criminal complaint against Vice President Sara Duterte and her security escorts. The Philippine Armed Forces chief replaced Duterte's security team after they were accused of interfering with the transfer of the Vice President's detained chief of staff. Bianca Dava reports.
Vice President Sara Duterte and several others are facing complaints for direct assault, disobedience, and grave coercion from the Philippine National Police. Aside from the Vice President, included in the complaints are Vice Presidential Security and Protection Group Head Colonel Raymond Dante La Chica and other John Does. The complaints, which were filed before the Quezon City Prosecutor's Office, stemmed from the disruption at the House of Representatives Detention Center and Veterans Memorial Medical Center involving the detention of Duterte's Chief of Staff, Attorney Zulaika Lopez. The PNP alleges Duterte's security detail assisted in the forced transfer of Lopez from the VMMC to St. Luke's Medical Center using a private ambulance. Meanwhile, armed forces of the Philippines Chief General Romeo Bronner Jr. denied reports he is taking over the security group of the Vice President.
Hindi po totoo yun na I will take over the VPSPG. It is still under the Presidential Security Command. No, kasi nga po, hindi ko po kayang gawin yon dahil marami po tayong iniisip na iba pang mga security issues ng ating bansa.
Bronner, however, confirmed that many members of the VPSPG will be temporarily replaced by new personnel from the AFP and PNP. This after the AFP received a subpoena from the PNP calling the VPSPG to be investigated.
Pinag-aaralan po natin yon, pinag-aaralan, according to the subpoena na binigay. No? Kasama yung commander because nga kasama siya dun sa subpoena.
Bronner stressed the security of the Vice President is a primary concern for the AFP.
Hindi po natin iwan because the security of the Vice President is still of primary concern to us. Dahil nga po, kung merong nangyari, let's say may nangyari sa ating Vice President, maaring ito yung simula ng kaguluhan, no? because of yung salaysay na rin na binanggit niya na kung may mangyari sa kanya, no, meron po siyang mga actions na gagawin, no, against the President, the First Lady, and the Speaker of the House.
The VP-SPG currently has around 350 members. Bronner said he has yet to determine how many military personnel will be replaced. PNP spokesperson Jean Fajardo, meanwhile, said 25 police personnel will be assigned to the security group of Duterte.
This is a normal procedure. Kung kailangan may i-recall at kung kailangan i-add po, there's already an agreement on that aspect po. So with respect po sa case po ni Vice President po, there was a request from the Armed Forces of the Philippines to send a compliment po coming from the PSPG.
Bianca Dava, ABS-CBN News.